The basics of ZXDC displays. Hi, I'm Dave Cole, president of Colesoft and chief architect of the ZXDC debugger. This video will show the basics of ZXDC's displays and how to understand and exploit them. But first, let me offer a couple of important tips about viewing this video. This video is high def. It was created on a 1920 by 1080 display, so you should play it back in full screen mode on a similar display. Anyway, let's get started. I've got a debugging session already running in a batch job. Here's its opening salvo. There's a lot going on here, but let me start by pointing out just a couple of things. These messages are very important. They explain how to access ZXDC's extensive online help information. When you get a chance, you should read what's said here. For this debugging session, something called AutoMap is in effect. This means that load module maps and CSEC maps will automatically be loaded when needed. I'll have more about that in another video. Okay, let's go look at the program we're about to debug. To do that, just use the WHERE command. As we just saw, when this debugging session was started, automapping caused this program's ADATA map to be loaded automatically. That map is now being used by ZXDC to format our program in storage. In order for that to work well, a maplibs list must have previously been created, which identifies to ZXDC the datasets and libraries in which it can find ADATA. Okay, there's a lot going on here. Let's start unpacking it. To start with, all this bright yellow stuff at the top? That's all for just one machine instruction. My program's first instruction, a branch around an eye catcher. Notice that these statements are all assigned to the same storage address. It's all yellow because that is where the PSW points to. Also, you can tell the PSW points to here because of the arrowheads. All this other yellow stuff? That's just assembler fluff, commentary, macro calls, title statements, and such. Now, you'll also notice that the branch statement appears twice. There aren't two of them. It's just one branch statement shown twice. What's that all about? Well, most of what you see here was built from ADATA information. It shows the source statement images of your code. Even the displayed object code comes from the ADATA. But sometimes when generating a display, ZXDC will detect a special condition. And when it does, it will display the statement a second time. But this time, generated by disassembly of the object code from storage. This is so that it can show additional information that is not available from the ADATA. And what are such special conditions? Well, additional labels that come from sources other than ADATA, that's one special condition. And although it's not the case here, mismatches between ADATA's opinion of the object code and what's actually in storage, that's pretty special. And wherever the PSW points to, that's special too. And this location is where the PSW points. So the branch is shown twice. Trust me, there will be times when you will be glad that ZXDC does this double display. But when execution moves on, the next statement, a store modable, takes its turn to appear twice. And that second branch statement will disappear from the display. Oh, wait, it didn't disappear. Oh, that's because there's a second special condition here. This label, Z20SimEd, isn't from the ADATA map at all. This label is the name of the load module. So without the second display, it would have remained hidden. By the way, You see these little O's along here? They identify lines that were generated by disassembly and not from ADATA information. Well, except when they are obscured by the presence of the PSW. Now, most of my customers really like ADATA maps, but to my eye, they seem a bit cluttered. When that's the case, you can always redisplay storage using ZXDC's disassembler instead of ADATA. Just use the object operand on any storage displaying command, where commands, format commands, etc. This display shows the same storage but without all the ADATA clutter. The statement labels are still shown, but the fluff is now gone. Preferences like this are the kinds of things that can be customized with session profiles. I'll have more about that in another video. But for now, you probably would prefer just to see source images. So let's get back to that. Let's take a look down here at the bottom of the display where some very interesting stuff has been awaiting our attention. This is called a watch window. A watch window is an extra command line that contains one or more information displaying commands. These commands are retained and automatically re-executed every time you press enter. Our standard watch window command line contains a string of 5 commands. There's a list PSWE command. This displays the 16-byte extended format retry level PSW, along with selective formatting information. The retry level PSW is the PSW that will be in control when this program resumes. There's a list EPSWE command. This displays the 16-byte extended format error level PSW, also along with selected formatting information. The error level PSW is the PSW that was in control when a breakpoint or an abend occurred, leading to XDC receiving control. Let me digress a moment to touch on something important. In certain complex situations, the error level state can be very different from the retry level state. And when that happens, the reasons and consequences need to be understood. Consequently, ZXDC will issue loud and glaring warning messages when such situations occur. Here's a complicated situation, but a pretty common one too. Suppose my program issues an open SVC. This causes execution to pass to the system's open service routine, IGC0001I. Suppose then that an abend occurs, perhaps a 213, dataset not found. This will cause execution to pass to ZXDC. ZXDC now has 2 entirely distinct environments to manage and display. The error level is the environment that existed at the moment of the abend. This would include the registers, the PSW, the request block structure, the linkage stack, everything. The retry level will be the environment that will exist when you tell ZXDC to resume your program's execution with a trace or a go command. When you resume your program's execution, all elements of the error level environment are instantly purged. All request blocks newer than the retry level's request block are purged. All linkage stack entries newer than the retry level's stack entry are purged. The error level registers and PSW are simply abandoned. This abandonment is not a bad thing. It is what you, as the programmer, would want to happen. The bug, the cause of the 213 abend, is not in OPEN's code, so there's nothing to debug there. The bug is in your code that called OPEN's code. Your code told OPEN to open a dataset that does not exist. So there's nothing to fix in OPEN. The fix is to change your code or JCL to open the correct dataset. Also, this abandonment is necessary. It is a system integrity issue. Without it, non-authorized programs would be able to corrupt system services. Now, most times during a debugging session, the retry level and error level environments are the same. And most times when they are different, you want them to be different, as would be the case in this example. But sometimes when they are different, you really want them to be the same. And it is actually quite simple to make them the same. Just use the hook command. I'll have more about that in another video. In any case, when the error level and retry level environments are different, here's what ZXDC will show you. Let me show you how you might understand what's going on here. As the messages say, a list request blocks command is a good command to use here. This display shows the chain of services that have been called for the current task. Basically, my program has issued an SVC 19 to open a dataset. In my data control block, I provided for a DCB open exit. So open has issued a sync macro to pass control to that exit in problem state. That exit has hit an OC1. Notice that the error level is in the DCB open exit. That's where the OC1 was, while the retry level is back in my main program, where the SVC 19 was issued. There are two very different environments here. Different registers, different PSWs, different ABAN protections. Potentially, everything can be different. Well, there's a lot more to say about this, including how to get the retry level into the DCB open exit where you probably wanted it in the first place. But for now, let's get back to where we were. We were talking about the automatic commands issued by the standard watch window. And we left off just before discussing the list BEA command. This command displays the address of the branching instruction that jumped to the store multiple instruction. This is an unbelievably useful command for debugging ABANs at targets of wild branches, such as jumps to location 0, for example. Moving on, there's a list wide registers command. It displays the full set of 16 8-byte wide general registers. And there's a list access registers command. It displays the full set of 16 4-byte wide access registers. Clearly, the command delimiters are semicolons, and the double semicolons create white space. All right, see these plus signs? They indicate that this code was generated by macro expansions. Let's see what happens when execution gets beyond the macro. To do that a little more quickly, I'm going to use trace BY commands. Instead of just executing from one instruction to the next, TBYs allow us to let execution run to the next instruction that will, in fact, branch. Now, by branching instructions, I mean any instruction that changes the flow of execution. Branches, jumps, SVCs, load PSWs, whatever. But the TBY trace will stop only when the branching instruction is about to jump. It will not stop on instructions that are about to fall through. In other words, when I use TBY repeatedly, execution flows from one successful branch to the next. So now when I type TBY, execution will run from here to here. Pressing enter, we see now that everything from the store multiple down to the branch has executed exactly once. This branch has not yet executed, but when it does, ZXDC tells you where it will branch to. So let me type TBY again. And execution will branch to the E0133 end label. And it will then proceed to the next branching instruction that will, in fact, branch. Clearly, not very far in this case. So pressing enter, and here it happens. Okay, here's something to notice. The macro expansion code has disappeared. That's because execution is no longer within the macro's code. There are, of course, format settings for controlling this sort of thing. Here, let me show you. The list format command shows various aspects of formatting that can be changed to your liking. The set format command can be used to change them, or they can also be both displayed and changed by the profile command. This command opens up the profile menuing system. From here, you can display and change maybe 100 or so settings. For the format settings, put an S here and press enter. But I digress. You can explore these later yourself. So for now, let's just exit the profile menuing system. There are various PF keys that you can use here. I'll just use PF5 to quit the menuing system altogether. Any changes that you make in the profile menuing system can be permanently saved in any one or more of your own personal profiles. Notice, you can have multiple session profiles. Just give them all unique names. Of course, there's a lot more to say about session profiles, but that's a topic for another video. Okay, let's take a break at this point. There's a lot more to show you here, but I'm going to put that off to another video. If you have any comments or questions about this video or anything else having to do with ZXDC, feel free to contact our staff directly. We can be reached by email at techsupport@colesoft.com or by phone at 540-456-6164. Thanks for watching. I'll see you again soon. Bye-bye.